The spread of the Delta variant of COVID-19 is causing record number of cases in Florida, Louisiana, Colorado. Meanwhile, so-called breakthrough cases are occurring among people who are fully vaccinated. How great a threat is the Delta variant? And are vaccines becoming less effective with the increase of infection among the vaccinated? Here with answers and insight, we're joined by Dr. Stephen Smith, an infectious disease specialist and head of the Smith Center for Infectious Diseases and Urban Health in New Jersey. Dr. Smith, thank you for being here. I want to begin with the Delta variant. The CDC now estimates that Delta accounts for more than 82%, maybe 93%, I've read in one report, of the cases here in the United States. A standard COVID test won't tell you if your infection was caused by the Delta or another variant of the virus. What's the difference? And should we be concerned?
There are a couple of different questions in there, of course. The Delta variant is a variant that, just like we expect to see when viruses spread, and you get variations in them naturally, and the evolutionary forces that cause those changes aren't always understood, but certainly that to do with spread and the ability to replicate in humans. As I was talking with your producer before, it's hard to imagine something more infectious than the virus we dealt with in March and April of 2020, but, you know, it's possible. Mm-hmm. But it is, when you have variants that has one leg up on the other, then the one that, it's survival of the fittest. And that fitness doesn't have to be pathogenicity. In other words, it doesn't have to be the ability to make someone sick. It can often be the opposite. It has to do with spread and durability, those sorts of things that lead to one variant taking over another.
It's the same virus mutating.
Viruses always mutate. They have very high mutation rate. And then these mutations that happen naturally are selected for because they're better at something. It's an accident. It's an accidental mutation just by random. But that random leads to it having an enhanced ability to do something that makes it more fit to live with humans. But that doesn't mean it's going to make people more sick. It just means it's going to spread better, or it's going to, actually in some cases, virus can weaken, but spread better. Because if you're not really sick, you're out there spreading the virus. And that's happened in many times, in many instances with viral infections, is that they weaken over time with mutations. And because the virus doesn't like killing its host.
Is that what you think we're seeing here? More spread, but less lethality?
No. I was saying that's what usually happens. I'm saying when we have variations in virus or variants, they're often weaker as far as pathogenicity. That's the ability to make people sick. That's not true for Delta, unfortunately. I wish it were true. It seems to be as virulent, or as that's a strength of ability to cause disease. Delta appears to be just as able to cause disease as wild type. Well, that means the original strain of virus that we dealt with in March last year.
On ABC News this week with George Stephanopoulos, a director of the U.S. National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases, Dr. Anthony Fauci, had this to say about the rise in COVID cases and what we can expect in the future.
So we're looking not, I believe, to lockdown, but we're looking to some pain and suffering in the future because we're seeing the cases go up, which is the reason why we keep saying over and over again, the solution to this is get vaccinated, and this would not be happening.
What do you make of his comments there, Dr. Smith? And what about the breakthrough cases when you've got Provincetown with 75% of the cases were previously vaccinated individuals?
Well, I'll take the first one, second one first. So the Provincetown outbreak, as you mentioned, was, I guess, like a fair event. And there was several hundred cases, 75% were fully vaccinated. Only five got admitted to the hospital and no one died. So, that's the bad news. Good news is that most of the breakthrough cases do well. And that's okay. I'd rather them not occur. But it's important that it's more important how the people do. The other part about that is we're just now starting to get information on protective levels of antibodies. There's two reports, one in Nature, one in New England Journal in the past couple of weeks, looking at something called neutralizing antibodies. Antibodies are proteins that our bodies make to fight off viruses. You know, if you have a vaccine, you develop antibodies against that virus or that piece of virus. And that's no different with either SARS-CoV-2 infection or vaccine. You develop antibodies. But it's also the type of antibody. So there's two things, the level of antibody and whether it's neutralizing or not. You're going to hear a lot of it about that if you haven't already, the adjective neutralizing. So neutralizing antibody is not all antibodies are neutralizing. A neutralizing antibody will bind to the virus and neutralize it, meaning it renders it non-infectious. So you put the neutralizing antibody in with the virus and it can't infect cells. And so that's what they're looking at. And that's going to be very important, is to see, can we really discriminate easily between people that are vaccinated at risk and people that are vaccinated and not at risk? And also you can follow that over time to determine if and when a booster would be needed. So those data are very, very important, and they're called correlates of protection. As far as what's going on, the second question, with what the news I've heard from CDC and NIH, it's confusing, but it seems like the first wave of people really wanted the vaccine, then there was some reluctance, and some people got induced by some incentives. Now it seems to be a scare tactic. They said, you know, they're trying to scare people, it seems. That's what I read, doing the leaves. You know, they've gone from trying to encourage people to scaring people. And I think it's the wrong way to do it, of course. I think the government's been way too heavy-handed about the vaccine to begin with. You know, it would have been much better if they just, you know, identified the high-risk groups and didn't insist on teenagers and kids having to have it, for instance, or people that had infection. My brother had COVID. His doctor caught COVID in March or April last year, pretty sick. Got better, thank goodness. Yes, he took hydroxyazithro. And then he got the vaccine. I told him to get the vaccine in December, and he got it. And he was in bed for like 2 days. You're not going to get the second dose. Wow. He's not fully vaccinated. I can tell you he's immune, but because he's had the infection and the vaccine. So that's at least two doses, or the equivalent of two doses of vaccine. And you know,
that raises
that
a good point.
It's got to stop.
Yeah, this raises a good point, Dr. Smith. We're talking now about vaccine mandates in places like New York City. Yeah. There's talk I hear from other localities, and they're seeing a spike in the number of people who are then willing to go and take the vaccine. My question is this. Why is there no emphasis, unlike we're seeing in France, their vaccine passports take into account natural immunity? And whether you have T cell immunity or not, we're not even having that discussion here in the United States.
Yeah, it's been really bizarre. You know, the CDC quickly flipped in May after should have flipped their opinion on antibodies earlier, but they quickly flipped out of blue early May, saying, you know, if you're fully vaccinated, you need antibodies. But this country was very reluctant and is very reluctant to say who is fully vaccinated, right? Who's responded to the virus through natural infection. That we can do, and that we should do, and we have not. Mm-hmm. And it's been very disappointing. We know natural infection, if you have an immune response against natural infection, it's highly protective. And there's some caveats there, but very few caveats. You know, if you're really much older, your immune system's very weak. But for the most part, the great majority of people that recover from natural infection have good protection against reinfection, and certainly great protection against serious reinfection. So it's been weird the way they've dealt with it from the beginning. They should not do the mandates as much as be rational about this thing, talk to people about it, explain things to them more, and give them choices. And I know several doctors, you know, my brother's hardly alone, that reacted to the first dose after getting infected while at work, nurses and doctors, and they're not gonna get the second one. but I don't know who's checking and how they're checking.
That's the question. Move. You know, and I've asked friends of mine who are restaurateurs in New York, you know, who's going to check this? He said, well, I got a guy who used to work as a bouncer. I'm bringing him back, you know, 5 days a week. He'll just check at the door. What does he know? How did he become an epidemiologist? But the director of the National Institutes of Health, Dr. Francis Collins, had this to say to parents about wearing masks at home around their unvaccinated children. Watch.
parents of unvaccinated kids should be thoughtful about this, and the recommendation is to wear masks there as well.
Let me just follow up on that.
I know that's uncomfortable. I know it seems weird, but it is the best way to protect your kids.
Now, Dr. Smith, Francis Collins backtracked on that a little bit in a subsequent tweet. Is this the best way to protect kids? I mean, what I resent most of all here is we're demonizing children because they can't get vaccinated, they're too young, and making it seem as if they're vectors for the disease. What's the fact here?
The people at risk for disease, for serious disease, for disease that'll put you in the hospital, that's who gets vaccinated. That's all we care about. That's all we've ever cared about. You know, when rubella came out, the vaccine came out in the 60s. And my dad was part of that. And, you know, they were going to give it to girls because the only people at risk for serious disease are fetuses. So if the girl gets pregnant later in life and it gets rubella, then that fetus is at risk. So you target at-risk people. What are we worried about the kids for? When you vaccinate all the kids, there's a 100% chance that they're exposed to that risk, whatever how small that risk is, of side effects. There's a much lower chance of them getting infected than 100%, of course. And then the side effects of infection, we don't know, and kids are extremely low. So it's been really wrong from the start, is the way they've dealt this whole thing. And masks, don't get me started on masks. I mean,
you've already opened up my next question. What do you make of this reappearance of the mask mandates? We're having them here in Louisiana. Is there evidence that the masks are effective at preventing the spread of this virus, particularly when people are using, like, you know, dish rags and T-shirt fabric over their faces?
Well, and also, if you're drinking coffee, remember, you know, coffee's protective, apparently. If it's hot, I guess. I'm not sure if iced coffee's protective. And if you're on the court in the NBA, you're protected because COVID respects the game. Remember that, too.
I'll make note of that.
You know, it's a scare tactic. The mask, I think it was, you know, first it was the carrot, now it's the stick. To use that horse analogy, to get people to take the vaccine. If you don't get the vaccine, and that was the carrot with the vaccine, you could come off the mask, right? Well, they didn't check. And maybe a lot more people would have bit that carrot, to extend that analogy, if they did vaccine passports. But there's a lot of reluctance in the U.S. to do that, whereas other countries are matter-of-fact about it. And, I'm stunned by it, but you can't have a carrot that anybody can get. It's not a carrot anymore. You can just say you're fully vaccinated and take off your mask. So that's just a scare tactic. We've thrown out science. There's no science to back Dr. Collins' policy. The kids aren't vaccinated, but you are. I'm confused
so
as to
what's
what
the
his
fear?
Rationale is. If the parents are vaccinated, they're not going to give it to the kids. So I don't really understand what he was talking about.
This is what I'm saying. You're right. It sends the perverse message that the vaccines don't work. You've got the CDC and the NIH head basically making an argument for why maybe you shouldn't get the vaccine because you got to wear a mask around your child anyway. I mean, brings up the next question. Should children who are still, there's no evidence that they're major carriers or spreaders of COVID, should they be wearing masks in schools? We're seeing school districts authorize demand mask mandates in the fall.
Now, only on the stage, you know, when they're playing a bandit or something. No, they should not be wearing masks. That's idiotic. You know, again, there's no science. The science that exists doesn't back that at all. The masks are not protective. Remember, the masks are theoretically, the masks are to, if you're asymptomatically infected and don't know it, you're going to reduce spreading it from you to them. It doesn't protect the wearer. We know that. Mm-hmm. So now it's about, they made up this thing about reducing the spread of droplets into the environment if you're wearing a mask early in infection or you know, you're just too stubborn to stay home when you're sick. I don't even know why this is even a theory. These masks have been studied in influenza before COVID and didn't work. You know, the masks are loose, so the air just gets redirected.
Right.
It's not being filtered.
Yeah. Now, I just want to say for the audience before I ask you this question, you, Dr. Smith, have treated hundreds of patients infected with COVID-19. I want your thoughts as a working physician, a treating physician. What do you make of Mayor de Blasio's mandating this vaccine in New York City? Is this a good thing? Is this a positive development?
No, it's a bad thing. I mean, you know, like I said, the heavy-handedness of the government, they just can't resist themselves, it seems, is way out of line. You know, it's not supported by the data. And at least New Jersey, I can check the New York City data. We're seeing a slight uptick in infections. We're not seeing an uptick in admissions yet. I don't know what's going to happen in the future. I've been loath to predict things about COVID. And I think I've benefited from not predicting things. But, you know, that's just a heavy-handedness that's got to stop. You know, again, I think if they really wanted to do something, they should have done the passports and said, you know, if you're going to take off masks, you got to show your passport or something like that. I don't know. I mean, but to mandate vaccines, and then how are they going to monitor that? That's the part I don't get. If they don't have the vaccine passport thing going on, how are you going to mandate vaccines? How are you going to know if someone's got to – they will then have to institute some sort of vaccine passport or credit card or whatever it is to check, right?
Yeah, well, these guys were talking about this a long time ago, about the passport routine. This was always in the cards. Somebody's going to make a bucket of money off of these passports. We should have gotten in the passport industry.
I'm not like, we're the guys not making money on it. But, you know, private companies apparently can do what they want. So they can require, you know, like a restaurant can require you to show proof of vaccination or participate in a group, in a company, like a credit card. You can imagine a passport, a vaccine card that some third party develops and is responsible for vetting out and making sure that the person, you know, that ID badge is vaccinated. I'm surprised that maybe it is happening. I don't know.
The last time you were on the program, you spoke about a COVID vaccine that was still in development. It's still seeking approval, this Novavax vaccine. There have been reports that this version of the vaccine could be highly effective against the Delta variant. Those trials were released. And I know there are now questions emerging about the spike protein created from the other vaccines, the ones so far approved by the FDA. Where are we with this Novavax COVID vaccine, and when might it be available?
You know, I thought it would be available by now. I actually was just looking prior to coming on the air to see if I can even find out if they filed with the FDA. I know they planned to file in May, and then I don't know if that happened or not. I don't even know if they filed. So the FDA can't give EUA, the expanded use access, if they don't file. Mm-hmm. I really don't know the holdup. It's been tough to discern from the available data, you know, basically the press releases. So it's very effective. It's very safe. It's just the spike protein in solution. You know, there's no virus. There's no RNA. It's an old-fashioned type of vaccine. The best vaccine we've ever had, hepatitis B virus vaccine, is that, you know, the equivalent. That type of vaccine, just the envelope protein for hepatitis B. And when these vaccines work, they're great. And this one, the data are great. And you're right, it works against Delta. So, you know, when people have asked
about getting a booster. Well, that's why you've got the Singapore and Britain, they've already bought and made contracts with Novavax. And here we're still stalled with the FDA, which I don't quite understand. Very quickly, Dr. Smith, and you may not know about this, but I'm going to ask you anyway. I've read some data. There was a report on this Pfizer data that was submitted to the FDA, and then later they had to submit to the Japanese government. And there, a researcher in Canada is claiming that the data shows that this spike protein from the Pfizer shot, that may be part of the cause for the heart inflammation and clotting and other issues that we're seeing from that vaccine, that it's actually the spike protein replicating in other parts of the body. Your thoughts on that?
Well, it doesn't replicate, but it what we don't know is does it trigger a autoimmunity. It's expressed with inside our cells, the spike protein, with the mRNA vaccines. Mm-hmm. That's not true with Novavax. Novavax, the protein comes and stays outside the cells. So the immune response is much different when you have a protein outside the cell or one that's now expressed within our own cells. Now, within our own cells, there's probably a greater chance for causing what we call autoimmunity. So now you're not only making antibodies against the spike protein, but against yourself. And that may be going on. And one of the other things we were worried about from COVID from the beginning was, would these vaccines induce autoimmunity? Because that's a big worry with every vaccine.
You know, where your body's turning on your own cells. Your immune system is turning on your cells.
Yes. And autoimmune diseases can be awful. Like lupus is a classic autoimmune disease. Rheumatoid arthritis, another autoimmune disease, where your immune system, auto, self, and immune. So now your immune system attacking yourself, and that's not good. And it can be very painful. Now, it could be that the intracellular expression, in other words, the mRNA vaccines or the adenoviral vector vaccines, they're inducing a type of immunity that increases the chance of having autoimmunity and autoimmune symptoms. That's probably true. Now, what level? I don't know. We do know that vaccines can induce autoimmunity. That's probably what they're talking about. And that was the strange rush to have intracellular vaccines like the mRNA vaccine and the adenoviral vector vaccine. They were pushed ahead of the Novavax approach, which is the simpler one. The latter approach is simpler, and I don't know why they weren't pushed simultaneously. The adenovirus vector and the mRNA approaches are new. They've never been used in humans.
These are new technologies, and that's what was so. When you have an old school approach, I don't know why you wouldn't just go with that. But for whatever reason, the FDA decided to approve what is a new vaccine technology, which is what we're talking about in these three existing COVID shots
here in the
United States.
Four different technologies to be. It's actually the funding was more important than the approval. They funded at least two adenoviral vector. I think we funded both adenoviral companies. And then we funded at least one of them. Then we funded both mRNA companies. Those are all individual. Those are all slightly different technologies.
Dr. Smith, I wish I could talk longer. Thank you for not only the clarity, but the time on this issue, because we don't talk about these details enough. And they are critically important, not only to our health, but those of our children and our neighbors and our friends and our whole community. Thank you for the time, Dr. Smith.
My pleasure.